Hello, ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the show. Glad to have you guys here on this September the 16th, Friday, 2022. Thank you for tuning in. I'm glad to have you guys here. Now, here's what I want to talk about. I tell you, you guys got to prepare now. Prepare by food, for one thing. You need, I'll tell you, in order to survive in this world, you only need several things. You need a source for water, clean water. You need a bed someplace that is dry and out of the weather. And you need food. And of course, you need the other things that the earth provides, things like air. Can't survive without air. But, you know, you're going to be in jeopardy of these things not being available that you've always assumed are available. The things that you need in order to survive. And you need to start preparing now. Because I'm going to tell you guys what. We've got a number of problems in the world. And some of them are big and insurmountable. The divisions that's being created between East and West. Between the Western side of the world and the Eastern side of the world. These are unresolvable divisions that are being created. At the same time, we got a society that is marching toward destruction of its own food supplies. They're trying to move too quickly toward technological advancement. It's going to take its toll on people. And what I mean by that is we've got countries like, take Germany, for instance, this winter. How much do you think the people are going to stand food prices going through the roof, wages not going up, and them being cold at the same time, and energy prices just skyrocketing before the people all of a sudden hit a fermenting point where they just start to, you know, I mean, I used to make wine, you know, when I was a lot younger than I am now, you know, I used to use a method by which I get a bottle, you know, and one of the things about me, I was fascinated with the fermentation process. I used to watch the bottle and see when it would start to ferment. And this is the thing. This is just like watching a bottle that all the conditions are right, and you know it's going to start to ferment. What's going to ferment amongst mankind? Because the conditions are right? Civil unrest. Now, what does that mean? What is civil unrest? Well, it can take many different forms. And the most often form that we're used to seeing is when people get out there and they protest. Well, the government has learned how to handle that now. They just basically ignore it and send their squads out to quell it and stop it, stop the protest. And they just wait until the people go home. But protest can change form from protest when the people feel like they're being ignored, to something more. Something much, much more. And that something much, much more can cause widespread outages in the type of system we have. Because we have a system that's extremely dependent. And basically, if the people themselves start to actually sabotage the system, basically, it's like this. You get an angry person out there and they lose it. They, what we term now, lose it. They lose it. They can do untold damage to the system, the structure of the system. They could, I mean, just use your head. Think about what they could do. And you get groups, large groups of these people. The destruction that they could impose upon the system. They're actually, they could themselves shut the system down to where nothing can get through. Trucks can't get through. Electricity can't get through the lines. You say, well, how could they bother? You don't know what people can actually do when they're in mobs and they're really angry and they start to actually tear the system down around them. The structural damage that they can do to the system. And this affects all of us because it means that your grocery store might not be able to get the food through. We almost seen this happen here in Canada. They started to block highways off where the food passes between the United States and Canada for a period of time. And emergency laws were invoked here in Canada. It did stop the situation. But what about when this is worldwide and all the people are upset and they start to basically tear the system apart with their bare hands because they think that the government doesn't listen to them anymore, listen to their grievances anymore, which they don't. And that the people are going hungry. And this is all right on the doorstep of this happening. The situation right now in the entire world, entire global Western economy, you have to analyze the situation. Okay, so we're going to analyze the situation right now. What do we got? We've got the people who have had 40 years of credit expansion and they've lived the good life. All their life, they've never really wanted for anything. Since the baby boomer generation, it's been good times since World War II ended. We continued to expand our credit during these years. And people take out loans, you know, the standard stuff, you know, and build new houses were being built and highways were being built. And people had anything that they wanted. Oh, you want lobster tonight? Well, just go to the store and buy some lobster. Or go to a restaurant and buy some lobster. You can have lobster. Anything you want. And we've had generations that have grown up underneath this. And they feel entitled and privileged. Well, they don't really feel privileged. They just feel entitled. And, yeah, that's the word I was thinking of the other day. Entitled. They really feel entitled. They're spoiled, basically. They haven't went through the hardships that the people went through back in World War II, the hardships people went through during the Great Depression and so on. They haven't went through that. And so when you thrust this upon them suddenly and you start to decide, okay, we're going to take everything away from them that they have. In other words, maybe they're living in an apartment. I'll give you an example, you know. And maybe all of a sudden, you know, they find that their bills are getting too, and they can't put their rent together every month. Well, all of a sudden, food prices start to explode. Energy costs start to explode. Next thing you know, they're being forced out of their apartment. And they have hard choices to make. Do I feed myself this month, or do I have my, and then it gets right down to the hardest choice of all. Are they able to keep their cell phone? To pay their cell phone bill? When you get masses of people who feel entitled and all of a sudden everything starts to get taken away from them, you think they're just going to sit there and say, oh, yeah, okay, well, I'll starve. I'll just sit in the corner over here and starve and I won't say or do anything. No, they're going to group together. We haven't seen this phenomenon yet. It hasn't occurred yet. But I'm pointing it out to you guys, and you guys know I'm always ahead of the curve. When there's a big problem, I always tell you first about it. Well, this is a huge problem. Because as this discontent turns to changes its form, it morphs from peaceful protests into let's block highways off. And when they start to say that, and they start to think that way, and then they start to do it, and then they start to attack the infrastructure of the countries, and there's no putting them down, less bringing the military in and basically waging war against their own citizens. When it gets to that point, then expect things to happen, like all of a sudden you got no power because something that they've done is shut the power off. You go to the grocery store and They've smashed all the windows out in the front of the grocery store, and there's no food left in any aisle for you. This is what you're preparing for, because this is what I see moving to the next step of this whole thing, because they're going to try to quell this, to stop it ahead of time, the government. And they're not going to be successful. So what's the next step? Is they're going to try to quell it by giving the people money in the form of a central bank digital currency. And this is going to be a panacea for a short period of time. But as the central bank digital currencies, looking further in, like looking into later next year and into the following year, as the CBDCs start to lose value, then they're going to completely lose control over the mobs. But that's stage two. We're entering into stage one of this. And stage one of this is you need to prepare for this as best you can all the way through it. This is going to last a while. It's going to last quite a little while before it finally reaches a conclusion where basically what we're probably looking at in the final conclusion of all this is the system actually shutting down for maybe 4 to 6 months. Or what they refer to as an SHTF, ultimately. So that's going to be what the hyperinflation's conclusion is going to be. But we're a ways from that. We got to go through the acceleration phase first. And if you don't know what the acceleration phase is, you always have an acceleration phase that leads into a hyperinflation. We haven't had the acceleration phase. All we've had so far is inflation. We haven't had the acceleration phase. We're going to have the acceleration phase. It's going to come after the Fed capitulates to the system and changes their monetary policy back to an easy monetary policy. We're going to start to enter into the acceleration phase of the hyperinflation. And that's where prices start to really start to shoot through the roof. You'll look back to the good old days when we only had what they call 8% more or less inflation on the CPI. When it goes over 100% per year, the CPI, I mean, they don't even register it anymore. It's just like we've got accelerating inflation leading into the hyperinflation, which will probably last 6 months to a year or something like that. But then the real hyperinflation will hit. And at the conclusion of the hyperinflation, ultimately, the system has to shut down for a reset. And during that period in time, you're going to get 4 to 6 months where basically everything just stops. It's that period in time you're going to see your massive population decline. When it's over, the world will be totally different. It'll be a brand new world. Something you're not familiar with at all. At all. That's when the structure is going to change to what I've told you guys about, where you're going to have bad land areas, where there's just going to be no people dwelling anymore, ghost cities, ghost towns everywhere, because the population has declined to a point where there's just not people to occupy those houses anymore. They're all gone. The houses are still there, and they're just going to rot into the ground, be occupied by wild animals or whatever. I mean, it's going to be something like in a post-apocalyptic world when this thing finally resolves itself, when the hyperinflation finally comes to its conclusion, where the dollar's worth zero. You just can't transfer all of that wealth out and transfer it into something else, what we call a reset. You just can't do that without it causing a massive distortion in the system, because the whole world runs on money. Or what we call money, which is not really money. But you guys got to prepare now, because we're getting so close to all of this that you've got to ensure, you have to ensure that you're going to have a warm place to sleep, a meal to eat, and water to drink. You have to ensure that for yourself. And the best way to ensure that for yourself is to not insure yourself with the hyperinflating money, but to insure yourself with what has been money for 6,000, 7,000 years. Real physical gold and silver. So if you're all in cryptocurrency, you don't have any real gold and physical and gold and silver, you should start thinking twice. And the next thing you need to do is, if you can, prepare with food and water and an emergency kit and things that you'd need in the event of a disaster, because this winter is going to be a disaster, especially for the people who are listening over in Europe right now. And I've said for years that this whole thing is going to start over in Europe. It's going to be first Europe. It's going to hit Europe hardest first. I've been saying that for years. And then it's going to transfer over here to North America. It's going to spread like a disease or like a fungus. This problems that humanity is going through to make this adjustment to a different type of society. The computers are going to take over ultimately in the end. And that's the adjustment we're going through. This is referred to as a singularity. We're going to enter into a world where you're not going to interact with other people whenever you want to do business or anything. You're mostly going to interact with computers and stuff. But there's going to be a huge black market outside that where humans interact and do business with each other, which I was talking about, I think, in my shows, last couple shows. And that'll probably be gold and silver, because they won't want any way the system can track them, because the system's eyes are going to be everywhere. The system's eyes are going to be looking at you from the sky, and satellites that fly over are going to get so powerful they're going to be able to spot a pin on the ground. The system's eyes are going to be listening to you on everything that you own that's what's called smart. A smart watch, smartphone. They can hear you 12, 15 feet away, even if you whisper. And the computers analyze all that. It's the same technology as the facial recognition technology. And it's AI technology, and it's increasing exponentially now at this point. The AI is going to merge, and technological advancement's going to merge very quickly now. Because this is all part of the whole parcel, is the civil unrest is going to be moving very quickly at the same time, accelerating. And so we're moving in a world that's so unfamiliar and so hard to stay ahead of it that you need to prepare. You need to prepare yourself. And if you haven't started, you need to get starting. And you say, well, how do I start to prepare? Well, it could be as simple as going into your grocery store and buying a one of those packs of, you know, the big packs of bottled water and putting it in the trunk of your car. They only cost like, I don't know, maybe $5 or something, you know. And I mean, so even a person that doesn't have a lot of money can do that. And that's the first thing people run out of when there's a crisis. A hurricane, anything hits. People in America right now have just went through this crisis down around the Mississippi. It was the first thing they needed was fresh water, and they didn't have. Okay, so that's one of the first things you can do to prepare. One of the next things you can do to prepare is an emergency medical kit. The next thing you can do to prepare is canned foods. And don't go out there and buy things like that don't have any caloric value in them, like green beans. I'm not saying green beans are bad, but I'm just saying think things that have a high caloric value. Things that are going to fill your stomach up and keep you for a while. Not just a bunch of candy bars. Now, candy bars are good, but that can be a final touch. That can be like if you're like the icing on the cake is, you know, your candy bars and things like that. But, and you should have that. You should have a few junk food that you can snack on if the world's falling to pieces. You know, I mean, it might do good to have a few things like a few bags of potato chips or stuff like that, you know? But you need to get the core stuff put away first. Things like cans of beans and things like that. Things that are going to, you know, maybe like some Campbell's soup or something like that. And it's just, you can just start small. One good sized bag of groceries that you're going to put away, like a lot of canned food and stuff, you're going to put away and save for a rainy day. And you're going to need to rotate these supplies as time goes by. A couple years goes by in your canned goods. You have to start to eat the stuff. So buy the stuff that you like to eat. The canned food that you'd like to eat. Canned food lasts a long time. It's easy to put away. Just got to make sure it doesn't freeze. That's all. And that might be difficult, especially some places in Europe this winter, to make sure that your supplies don't even freeze. I'm telling you, this is going to get rough, guys. And I know some of you have a very hard time to start to try to prepare anything. Food prices skyrocketing. They've made this situation for all of us. Anyway, I'm going to get into the markets now. I'm going to run through the markets real quick before the end of the show here. Because I'm getting quite deep into this show now. I've talked 21 minutes. But it needs to be said that you need to prepare now. Because things are getting really, really serious at this point in time. The situation is closing in on us. There's not a lot of time left. The great Ponzi scheme, the greatest Ponzi scheme ever run by mankind, is starting to fall apart because it's such a huge, enormous Ponzi scheme. It is taking quite a long time for it to fall, but it's falling. Anyway, get in there and take a look at the silver price today. $19.39, it's up 22 cents, which is good. Gold, we're looking at up $11.50 at $16.76. We're going to take a look at cryptos. Bitcoin price is $19,663 and Ethereum is $1,446. On to the Dow Jones today. And the Dow Jones today is down 334 points. Okay, so we take a look at this right here. Fed capitulation. And the Fed caving in to this market and giving the market what it wants and needs, which is a lot more printing. Well, they don't really print anymore, but a lot more creation of new monetary units into the system. That's what the market needs to go up. And they will. They're going to capitulate. But we're probably going to be down, way down here, way down like 25, 26,000 before the Fed's going to start to get nervous. And the way they're talking and everything, I wouldn't be surprised if they actually hold off. And we could see prices of the market go on the Dow Jones go down in the low 20s, even below 20 even, below 20,000 even. It's possible. Excuse me. That is possible. Because they're really, really trying to hold the line on this. Because they know when they finally capitulate, they know that it means that the dollar is going to start to really lose value fast after that point in time. And so they're going to be very hesitant to capitulate, even though the markets are going to continue to slide and slide and slide. But there's no bottom to this. This market could go down to 5,000 before it would finally start to think, hey, you know, because it's been pumped up that high on the other side of it. So let's take a look now at oil. Crude oil is up 17 cents at 85.27. Move index today, 124.07. Taking a look at bonds and rates today, we are looking at a mixed bag. So we're looking at the 10-year falling 4.3 basis points at 3.41. And we're looking at the U.S. 30-year at 3.47. Now, we've got huge inversions here in these yields. I mean, you know, the U.S. six-month yield at 3.8 and 3.4 for 10 years. So what do you want, 6 months or 10 years? Look, the U.S. 1 year at 4%. It's even more than 30 years, the 30-year. I mean, these are inversions like absolutely massive inversions in yields. Doesn't this tell you that the crisis is coming? If this doesn't tell you the crisis is coming, nothing else will. That's what I mean. You got to prepare now. It's time to prepare. It's time to get serious about preparation. If you've been sitting on the fence, and like I say, it's easy to start. You just start with a bit of bottled water, emergency kit, and some canned food. And that's a good first start. You know, clean out a closet in your house that you probably got full of old tennis rackets and stuffed teddy bears and stuff like that. Clean it out and put your emergency preps in there. Look at what the people in Mississippi had to go through with water recently. You know, look at what the people in Texas had to go through the other year when the power went out. You know, a couple blankets even. Clean out a box, you know, and on top of all your other stuff, after you get all your other stuff in that closet, like your canned food and all your heavy stuff, like bottled water, canned food, don't put your canned food on top of your bottled water. Don't make that mistake. You have water all over the floor. It'll crunch the bottles, you know. You gotta use a bit of common sense here, guys. If you've never prepped before, I need to tell some of you guys this stuff, though, because if you've never prepped before, the canned food goes down on the bottom because it's heavy and it's made of steel. The cans are made of, well, not steel, but tin. So they can go down on the bottom. They can take a lot of weight. Then you put the bottled water on top of the canned food. You can put that in your closet. And the canned food will support the bottled water. You know, and then put your other stuff like blankets and stuff like that way up on the top. They go on the top. The heavier stuff goes on the bottom, and the lighter stuff goes on the top. Just for you guys who are real novices at this. You know, I've been doing it for years, and a lot of other people have been doing it for years, and we've been waiting for this for years. We knew it was coming years ago. We knew this was coming in the end. We knew it's coming is math. That's how we knew. Because you just cannot continue to endlessly increase the money supply without the money supply losing value. This has been going on for 100 years. So of course we knew a long time ago. But we thought it was going to happen sooner. It's taken a lot longer than we thought. But it's finally getting here to the point now where it's getting to be like you can see the handwriting on the wall right in front of your face. It's right there in your face now. So you got to get started. If you haven't done it before, you got to get started. Otherwise, you're just going to be going hungry and going without food. You know, you've got your sources where you, every one of you out there has got your grocery store you always run to get your bottled water and canned food or whatever or food you want for the day. Or you got your favorite restaurant. Imagine the day when you go there to your grocery store and there's nothing inside and the windows are smashed out because some mob has been in there and they've trampled the place and taken everything. And they haven't even left a grain of rice on the floor. And then you go down to your local restaurant and they've got a big closed sign on the, because they're not even open to feed you. And there's nobody out there to feed you or give you water. And imagine if your house is empty and it hasn't got any food or water in it. And this happens suddenly. What are you going to do? What are you going to drink from? You'll be thirsty and you'll be looking outside at that old puddle that the cars have driven through all day. And the water's full of mud. And you'll be thinking to yourself, oh, I'm so thirsty. I'm dying of thirsty. Or what am I going to do? You'll be lifting off the lid on the back of your toilet. And you'll be dipping your cup in there into the tank to try to get water. You don't want that to happen. You want to have a nice, be able to walk over to your closet and everybody else is thirsty out there and you're able to walk over to your closet and open up your closet and take out a bottle of nice fresh bottled water and make your tea or whatever or drink it, knowing that you're drinking fresh water rather than you're not going to get something like some waterborne disease from drinking water from a puddle, because that's what we're going to come down to, because you're going to be on your own at a certain point in time. There's going to be infrastructure's going to fail. Anyway, I've stressed it enough to you guys. But I need to stress it. Some of you guys are listening to my show for the very first time and hearing all this for the very first time. I know some of you guys have heard it a lot times before, but you can do a bit more. And for the people who's hearing it for the first time, they're just getting started. You know what I mean? And I'm going to tell you, my audience reaches several thousands of people. And I'm going to tell you, there's probably going to be 40 or 50 people in here are hearing this for the first time. Seriously. Okay, U.S. dollar index today, 109.85. And see, this dollar, you know, it's been sliding upwards slowly but surely. It's crushing the emerging market economies because they've got a lot of loans, you know, and they need to pay back in dollars. And where are they going to get these dollars? There's a dollar shortage coming right now. It's going to be short in the system. Liquidity crisis. But it ain't going to last long because they're going to turn on the pumps again. That's what makes this whole situation so difficult for forecasters like me is because of this switching off the pumps and then turning the pumps back on again. Makes it very difficult to forecast, but I pegged it a long time ago, and a lot of the other forecasters out there now are catching on saying the same thing that I'm saying, but I was saying it way before they were on to it. Took them a long time to get on to it. Now they're on to it, and so now it's like preaching to the choir, you know, I mean, it's like, at this point, for me, it's like now all these other guys are saying the same thing I'm saying. But this is big. This is a big story. But they're not telling you guys that you need to prepare now, a lot of them. Some of them are, but you do. It's down to the wire now at this point. It looks like this thing's going to start to set in this winter. Set in really deep and hard this winter and into spring. It looks like by next summer, people out there will be facing gosh knows what situation should be facing by next summer. Thank you guys for listening to my show. Like and subscribe, and we'll catch you guys in the next episode. Bye bye.